Ocular trauma is the most common cause of secondary open angle glaucoma. Closed globe injury causes anterior posterior compression of the globe with an equatorial expansion, thus disrupting the uveal attachments to the sclera and damaging the angle structure. Immediately after this injury, we see a transient rise in intraocular pressure. Later on, we may see glaucoma in 10% of these cases, even 10 years later after the injury. Campbell describes 7 rings of trauma, which is seen after blunt trauma. The first one, that is the most anterior one, is the pupillary sphincter tears. This shows multiple pupillary sphincter tear. The clue is the pupil, you may have an anisocoria between the two eyes. Then there's a ragged margin of the pupil, and it remains in a mid-dilated state after this injury. The second one is iridialysis. There is disruption of the iris from its base or the root, and it produces a D-shaped pupil. The next one is angle recession, which is seen here. The iris becomes retroplace, and there is an increased distance between the trabecular meshwork and the iris, and there is an enlargement of the ciliary body band. Then we see the cyclodialysis, in which there is again a white, gray, or black band between the trabecular meshwork and the root of the iris. This shows a picture of iridialysis as well as cyclodialysis coexisting. Then we may have retinal dialysis, zonular dialysis, which produces lenticular subluxation, and vitreous base avulsion. Immediately after the injury, there is rise in IOP. It may occur due to multiple factors, of which we have hyphema, which is the most significant factor and causes a late increase in IOP also. Then we have inflammation and trabecular meshwork disruption. Hyphema occurs as the ciliary body gets separated from the sclera due to contrecoup effect, thus causing tears in the ciliary body involving the major arterial circle. Traumatic midriasis is the most frequent association which is seen with hyphema, followed by retrolental hemorrhage. Notably, 56 to 100% of the hyphemas may harbor angle recession, and therefore, after resolution of the hyphema, one must screen for the presence of angle recession. Sometimes after hyphema resolves, we may see a secondary hemorrhage on two-thirds of the cases, most prominently on the third or fourth day after the injury, but it never occurs after the fifth day. Visual results in those with hyphema and those requiring surgery are often poor. Secondary hemorrhage occurs due to uveal vessels which undergo ischemic spasm, followed by prolonged reactive vasodilatation, leading to, again, a hemorrhage. Various studies have been done to see with the presence of angle recession with hyphema, and the incidence of angle recession in these cases varies from 56% to up to 100%. Angle recession indicates anatomical cleavage between circular and radial circular ciliary muscle bundles, which is seen on gonioscopy as retrodisplacement of iris root, which is seen as wide open angles and a prominent ciliary body band. It actually indicates a histopathological injury to the trabecular meshwork, resulting in increase in IOP. The incidence of angle recession is 3.4% after blunt trauma during 6 months follow-up, but may increase up to 10% 10 years after the trauma, and therefore it has a bimodal presentation. We must not stop the monitoring of the patient who harbors angle recession for glaucoma, even later in the future. This is a UBM picture. On the left side, we can see that the angle is normal, but here there is an increased distance between the scleral spur and the iris root, which indicates the presence of angle recession. 9% patients with angle recession of more than 180 degrees will eventually develop glaucoma over long term. Fellow eyes of these patients with angle recession should also be monitored for the presence of primary open angle glaucoma and steroid responsive glaucoma, because those patients who develop angle recession glaucoma, they are themselves have a high propensity to develop glaucoma, and therefore fellow eyes should always be screened. These eyes also have a poor outflow facility, which is indicated by greater IOP peaks and IOP fluctuation seen on water drinking test. There are certain factors which can help us predict which patient is at high propensity to develop angle recession glaucoma once we know that he has angle recession on gonioscopy. These are poor initial visual acuity, advancing age, injury to the lens, angle recession, and hyphema. This was given by United States Eye Injury Registry. But a better guideline was given from our center only, which indicated the presence of increased pigmentation in the angle, elevated baseline IOP, hyphema, lens displacement, and angle recession of more than 180 degrees. They have very high propensity to develop angle recession glaucoma. Ghost cell glaucoma, it may occur after a blunt or penetrating trauma which has hyphema and vitreous hemorrhage. Once the hyphema clears, the conversion of fresh red blood cells to ghost cells occurs in the vitreous cavity. These ghost cells then travel anteriorly into the anterior chamber through a traumatic opening in the anterior hyoid phase and result in increased IOP due to trabecular meshwork clogging by these ghost cells, which can occur as soon as 2 weeks to 3 months later. Cyclodialysis is clinically defined as a broad band of white tissue, that is sclera, between the trabecular meshwork and the iris. This white band is cyclodialysis. The incidence is 2% after blunt trauma. Cyclodialysis usually results in decrease in IOP and is a protective factor for against a rise in IOP even if an eye is harboring angle recession. This indicates gonioscopy, which is quite difficult in an eye with hypotony and cyclodialysis. We can see the corneal indentation folds, and the gonioscopy in such eyes can be done under viscoelastic cover. IOP, however, in these eyes may increase later when the cyclodialysis cleft closure occurs due to inflammation. Iris tissue may also block these cleft and prevent hypotony. This is a UBM picture, which is more diagnostic and more specific to look for the presence of cyclodialysis. This we see a normal angle. However, a cleft is present here between the supraciliary space between the iris root and the sclera here. So ultrabiomicroscopy is used for cyclodialysis cleft identification, localization, and measurement. This is important if we are planning surgical correction in such cases. While gonioscopy allows evaluation from the anterior face of the ciliary cleft only, UBM provides a cross-sectional angle view. It can picture a cyclodialysis owing to the contrasting reflectivity of the aqueous and adjacent tissue. It is also useful during follow-up. Coming on to the penetrating trauma and glaucoma caused due to it, USEI gave an incidence of post-traumatic glaucoma in eyes which have sustained penetrating trauma to be 2.67%. The risk factors in increasing order are advancing age, lens injury, poor baseline visual acuity, and intraocular inflammation. We can see that intraocular inflammation is the most important and severe risk factor for us to know which eye can turn into glaucoma in such cases. So inflammation can cause iris bombé, lens swelling due to lens injury can also cause inflammation, and eventually all these things can lead to a vicious cycle causing a synechial angle closure, permanent changes in the angle, and eventual glaucoma. Trabecular meshwork occluded by red blood cells from a hyphema, inflammatory debris, lens particles, or ghost cells can also result in increase in IOP in such cases. In cases where there is a retained intraocular foreign body, it can cause siderosis and again a glaucoma. This is a case of ruptured anterior lens capsule, and we can already see that there is inflammation which is ongoing in this eye, leading to the formation of multiple synechae. So what is the management of angle recession glaucoma? It is one of those glaucomas which is refractory to medical therapy, but however, the first line still remains medical therapy in these eye. Beta blockers, alpha agonists, and carbonic anhydrase inhibitors are preferred. In case there is an active inflammation in the eye, please avoid the use of prostaglandins in such cases. Miotics may be ineffective in those eyes which have disruption of the ciliary muscle scleral spur relationship. And argon laser trabeculoplasty is not typically useful. However, if medical management or conservative management fails, we have to go for surgical options. Since these patients are usually young, they have high risk of failure of filtering surgery, and therefore it is must to use wound modulators in such eyes. This is a study which showed that in comparison to primary open-angle glaucoma, if we do a trabeculectomy in eyes with angle recession glaucoma, these eyes fail earlier at a mean of 3 months compared to 9 months in eyes with primary open-angle glaucoma, without the use of wound modulators. This bar graph also shows that at all time periods after the surgery, traumatic glaucomas have higher mean intraocular pressure compared to the primary glaucomas. This shows that they have higher inflammatory response, fibrosis of the bleb, and therefore wound modulators are must in these cases. When a study was conducted with glaucoma drainage devices, particularly Molteno implants in these cases, it was seen that 76% of the cases may achieve optimum IOP control with or without additional medicine cover. However, a large percentage, 29%, required further surgical intervention for implant complication like blockage or exposure. However, in eyes with penetrating trauma, the anatomy of the eye may be seriously disrupted, and none of the surgeries may achieve optimum control of the IOP. The vision prognosis may not be good. In such eyes, we may go ahead with cyclophotocoagulation. This was a study in which 6 cases of traumatic glaucomas were included, and 50% of them were found to have good IOP control after DLCP. So we have to weigh our own options, what option suits us best. Each patient has to be treated individually for him to get the best response. To conclude, 60 to 94% patients with blunt trauma show some degree of angle recession. In cases with blunt trauma, a complete ocular evaluation, including gonioscopy, is must. Periodic examination is mandatory in patients who harbor angle recession on gonioscopy, as glaucoma may develop even 10 years later. For penetrating trauma, if medical management proves ineffective, filtering surgery, tubes, or DLCP may be required. Thank you.